Good morning. I'm Jerome Ostentaski, President and CEO of the Central Rocky Mountain Permaculture Institute. We are a high-altitude demonstration farm. We have four greenhouses here at CRMPI. One of them is a tropical greenhouse where we grow tropical edible landscaping. We have papayas and passion fruit, bananas, and guavas. We have a Mediterranean greenhouse where we grow figs, rosemary, pomegranates, and we have two temperate greenhouses where we grow tomatoes in the summer and salad greens in the winter. Outside, we have an acre of edible landscaping where we have at least 150 varieties of fruits, vegetables, and medicinal and culinary herbs. We hold design courses. We are now in the midst of our 25th annual permaculture design course, which is a two-week practicum of learning how to create permaculture systems, looking at nature as a model and creating edible landscaping, learning how to harness all of your energy that comes into the site. And it's sort of, if you would go to Maine and you see the billboard as you come into Maine, it says the way it ought to be. Well, I think permaculture is the new paradigm, and it looks at natural systems and mimics them. And then we can build the sustainable future from that model. We're going to walk you through the Phoenix greenhouse to show you all of the edible landscape that we have here and show you how it's integrated and how it all works to create not only food and create for its own fertility, but it also creates a living space. It spills over. We have a wood-burning sauna, we have a pebble beach, we have an area to relax, we have a sleeping platform, we have a worm farm. And in permaculture, everything connects to everything else, just like it does in nature. And we have integrated pest management here, so we do not have to, spray any toxic chemicals to keep any of the bad insects out. The bad insects are managed by the good insects, or the snakes, or the spiders, or the worms create all of our soil fertility. We just add mulch, and the worms are constantly digesting that mulch and creating new soil. That's the way it happens in nature. If you go out into the temperate rainforest or tropical rainforest, nature takes care of itself. And we look at that model and set it up that way and do a small amount of innovation, and we guide it through a very productive phase. And that's how we can create a sustainable world. Well, we're standing in the east end of Phoenix, and about 2 years ago, we sheet mulched this whole area. That means we layered a lot of organic matter to build some new soils on top of the new climate battery. And then we planted annuals for the first 9 months. And some of these annuals are still in here. This is a bell pepper that has become a perennial. This is Anaheim. And we've been harvesting these for 2 years, so they're pretty well perennialized in here. But there is a succession of other plants that come in. During the summer, we plant melons, trellis them wherever they want to go. There's now a ground cover of medicinal herbs, which is spilanthes here and here. There's fava beans. This is a tagasasti, which is a nitrogen-fixing shrub for the Mediterranean. This is a tropical agroforestry tree called Lucayena. And that is fixes nitrogen for the papaya here. There's another papaya here, and there are two edible cactuses here. So this area is a what I call a stream of consciousness gardening. There's no end and there's no beginning. You start with annuals and you work towards a perennial polyculture of edible food and medicine. Right behind us we have yellow passion fruit, and from the center of the greenhouse we have the purple passion fruit coming in, and it is canopied over about 40 feet of the greenhouse, and there's over 150 passion fruits right now that are ripening. Scarlet runner beans crawling up here. There's other melons. There's all kinds of a hot pepper here. This is a jalapeno tree that's been here for 2 years. So we can nurture the annuals, and then gradually, as we want to change the palette, we can put in our perennial landscape. Moving on the other side here, we have some perennial vegetables. This is a perennial tuber, and comes from South America. This is either ginger or turmeric. I believe this is turmeric here. Artichoke here. We have flowering tobacco and a dill that we've let go to flower. And later on in the day, there'll be lots of beneficial wasps hovering over these umbels. And below this is alyssum, which is also an insect-attracting plant. And this is a volunteer tomato that's crawling wherever it wants to go. And we just guide it along. And along the pathway, as you can see, there are about 30 different citruses. And this is a voluntary cherry tomato that we've trellised as far as it wants to go, and it actually goes laterally along the stone wall. In the summer, we try to cover the stone wall to help cool the greenhouse. And in the winter, we expose it to have the sun coming in at the lower angle. And this is part of our passive thermal mass. Everything works, everything gardens. And right now, the pathway is gardening in a couple of different ways. Underneath this pallet, which has plywood on it, we have a worm farm. So we put organic matter down there, inoculate it with worms. We use it as a walkway. We also use it at, we have 30 citrus here growing for our nursery for additional things we put in this greenhouse and other projects that we do. We have basil in this particular bed right here. My perennial landscape is on the upper bed, but this is all annual landscape, edible landscape. There are five different kinds of sweet potatoes, each corralled in these boxes here. This is my version of square foot gardening. It's still stream of consciousness gardening, but it has somewhat an end and a beginning, because we can grow a crop in here for 4 months, turn it into a worm farm, put pallets on top of it, and then grow bedding plants on it. So it gives us a fallow time. And then we can go back into the next season, which could be right now, which is the hot season. We can plant basil and sweet potatoes. And then we rotate back into salad greens and root vegetables for the winter months. So there is this, again, stream of consciousness gardening, but everything's changing. And we're always looking out for the fertility of the soil. So we're always giving a fallow time. And this pathway can be cleaned out every 3 months or 4 months, and can be transferred, the material can be transferred up onto this bed, so that we're creating our own fertility. We're stacking time and space And in permaculture, we have principles where we're doing all kinds of multifunctioning, and everything is integrated, and everything is helping everything else, and nothing is left on its own. So that's what nature does. Nature never isolates anything. It doesn't reduce anything to a bucket of parts. It always is a living entity, and that's what we're trying to mimic in permaculture, and that works. We also work with successions, and we're actually in the middle of October, August right now, and we are harvesting cucumbers from here, but there's also some kale that's left over from the winter. There was salad greens in here, and kale, and now we're getting a good harvest of four different kinds of cucumbers in here. There's spilanthes here, which is a high-valued medicinal herb that's cascading over the rock. We get another cucumber right in here. More spilanthes. We still have some kale that we're harvesting, but we're also eating this outside in the greenhouse. So again, it's a stream of consciousness gardening. This fall, when we're ready to take the cucumbers out, we're going to plant jujubes in here, which is a tropical Chinese date, which is an immune system. And you can see there's a banana that's in a pot, but there's also passion fruit going in all different directions, using the trellises and the trusses to get more sunlight. And again, we have still some nursery here. Underneath here is a worm farm, and we can transfer this out into another area and plant right into that worm farm that will be very fertile for the next crop. And this is one of our climate batteries, and we can turn this on and set this at 75 degrees, and it will pull the hot air into the soil and heat the soil up to 75 degrees. It's like a big battery charger, like you're driving a car during the daytime. Your alternator is charging your battery. This is, in a sense, like an alternator charging the soil, putting the hot, moist air into the soil, and it stores it down to 5 feet in this greenhouse. And then during the wintertime, another thermostat here will kick the same fan on, going in the same direction, and discharge the soil. We'll set that thermostat at 50 degrees, so in the evening when it gets colder, then that will put the 50 degree air down into the 75 degree soil, and we'll come up at 65 degrees, and that will warm the greenhouse. And when that doesn't do the work, we have a wood-burning sauna that backs up and will heat the greenhouse and keep it from getting below 40 degrees when it's 20 below zero outside. And so those are we have the passive thermal mass with water, rock storage, and we have the active climate battery. And we are at 7,200 feet here, and we get temperatures down to 10 to 20 below zero. And we don't use any fossil fuel backups other than some wood burning, a wood burning stove in the sauna. So moving down along here, we have a good example of it's agroforestry. We have pigeon pea, and then up above is leucaena, these are both nitrogen fixing trees. And underneath we have citrus and avocado. Across the path is a tangerine there's cardamom and ginger in here, alyssum, fava beans, spilanthes, calendula, key lime. And jujubes up there. So each of these plants gets cut back. The nitrogen fixing plants gets cut back to let the light in for the fruiting plants. Then at that point they release their nitrogen in the root systems. And we also use their fodder, the trimmings that we cut from them to feed the animals or to use as mulch down on the ground. So in an alley cropping or agroforestry system, you are mimicking nature, and nature is full of nitrogen-fixing plants, one plant helping the other one. We come back in farther in here. We have olive, and there are five different kinds of bananas. All of these were put in 18 months ago from just very small transplants. And you can see this one is flowering here for the first time, so we should be having some bananas on the first clump of bananas. There are three major trunks, and then they take turns fruiting and putting out pups as well. So we have a banana nursery as well as fruiting. More basil. You can see the walkway goes here. I also have an archery range where I can shoot at 7,200 feet and practice my longbow in here. So again, lots of human activities. If we look outside, there's really no difference between the outside and the inside. There's a beautiful elderberry out there. There's 50 grapes in a little nursery there. There's cherries, and then there's hollyhocks, and there's 150 varieties of fruits and vegetables outside. Sweet potatoes over here make a nice perennial ground cover. And we have lemongrass, another avocado, another citrus, another nitrogen-fixing lucayena. And there's four more bananas in there, and guava across the way, and dragon fruit. So we're looking at all of the possible places here. This space is saved for cucumbers. So we have annual cucumbers along here. And on the west wall, we've placed our grapes, so we can get an early crop of grapes in June. And then our grapes outside, which we have about 25 varieties, will fruit in September and October. But we can put those in the greenhouse, and then we get a really early crop. Yeah, this is the oldest part of the tropical edible landscaping. It's about 18 months old, and these bananas here, they're about 18 inches at the bottom. There are three major stalks for each one, and this one should fruit next. And it's so heavy that we have to prop it up here. And we have sweet potatoes as a ground cover underneath. And we have guava here. And this is Highlands papaya, which you have five of these trees, and they've been fruiting for about 6 months now, and it's the base for our tropical smoothie we have almost every day. We can add a passion fruit to that, and we'll be adding bananas to that as well. We have a sleeping platform here, which allows us to do some yoga and take a nap, and I've created a little bow pulpit off the edge here so I can reach my fire pole and get down in a hurry if I need to. There's dragon fruit here, which is an edible tropical desert fruit. This is again a lab, which we cage, and this is an edible agroforestry bean. Creates an edible bean, but it also fixes nitrogen. And we have a lot of scented plants in here. We have night-blooming jasmine, which we've just begun to cut back and open up the canopy for the avocado in here. And we have another night-blooming jasmine over by the sleeping platform. More avocado, lab. Tangerine, passion fruit. And here's another kind of bean. It's in here, it's a beautiful. So we can put a pulse crop of any kind of beans and peas throughout the season, fava beans, snap peas, and every season allows us to grow a whole variety of new plants. We take the opportunity when it cools down to plant all the cold-loving plants. We've had broccoli and cauliflower as a ground cover in here for the last two winters, and fava beans, snap peas. And then when the season warms up, we'll move into more hot-loving things like tomatoes and basil. And so just using the natural successions of plants, that gives you the diversity you need so that the one plant isn't there for very long, and any disease problems are minimized that way, because you constantly move through the successions on most of your plants. The perennials are fine once they get established. They're very healthy, and they love what's going on here with the soils. And one of the things we can look at here is and how we're building soils. If we go under here, we can see what's happening. See, this is actually a living, moving soil. Any place you go, you're going to find worms eating up the organic matter. So this is a whole series of worm castings and worms digesting a variety of organic material. There's also mycelium in here, and somebody throws down a passion fruit. It goes into, this is fava beans, this is more lab. Sorrel. So, if you build the soil and keep adding mulches, the organic material, the organic worms, mycelium, bacteria, will continue to digest that, and they create the nutrients for the plants. So you'll have a healthy soil and you have healthy plants. And that's the way nature works in the long run. It happens in over millenniums of time. Here we can actually speed it up, and all of this is created in 18 months. So just by mimicking nature and being innovative, we can create a tropical, edible landscape at 7,200 feet within 18 months. One of the functions of our tropical greenhouse is creating living spaces. And it's really important if you live in a cold, dry climate to have a tropical environment to walk into every day. It saves a lot of airfare. You don't have to go to the tropics for vacation. You can just come down in here and
soak up the humidity and have a passion fruit, have a papaya. And creating multiple functional spaces, which is what we call, this is Pebble Beach here. We have a hammock, we have a gabion thermal wall, and a patio. And all of this is shaded now with the passion fruit by design. So we don't actually have to cool the greenhouse. In addition to the climate batteries, the thermal mass cools down. We have water tanks that are cooling down the place as well because they're shaded. And then all the passion fruit gets cut back in the winter and allows the sun to come down through at a lower angle and heat all of this thermal mass back. So in the wintertime, it's not shady here. It's very warm. In the summertime, it's shady, all by design. So we have passive and active cooling going on. And are also just a good place to hang out and dream and design and relax. Most commercial greenhouses are mostly intent on growing money. And what we try to do here is grow a multiple of crops and do the research and create a lot of living space and a lot of educational opportunities. So again, doing the perennial polyculture. Right behind me is the wood-burning sauna, and we'll have a look at that and how that integrates into the overall heating and cooling system. And this is a concrete bunker. It's insulated from the outside. It's 5 inches of concrete plus this scrap marble that's tied to the concrete. It's like walking into a masonry stove. There's the wood burning stove here is the firebox, and everything else is thermal mass. So after the sauna, you get the sauna as a bonus. Then you open the door, and the space heats up and continues to heat the greenhouse for 24 hours because there's so much thermal mass and it's so well insulated. There's also a little climate battery in here that will pump the hot air in the sauna down into the floor, into the rock storage, and into the flagstone so that you don't have cold feet when you're taking the sauna. There's no combustible materials in this material except for the railing here. So we're looking at any particular fire hazard. This is also like part of the healing center for Central Rocky Mountain permaculture, because on very cold nights you feel like you want to get your bones warm and your whole body warm and relaxed, so you can do stretching in here. And then that's exactly when the greenhouse needs the extra heat. We don't have any other propane or electric backup system, only the wood-burning sauna. And everything here is powered by a 6.3 kilowatt PV system. So all of the fans are really working off solar. So we have passive and active solar plus active PV that stores, that goes back into the grid and then gets used at night to turn on the climate batteries and use for circulation fans. So in a sense, we're totally off the grid in terms of running these greenhouses. They're all working with renewable energy.